Alice Schutz, Pen Name A.D.K. Luke, and the Law of Life Books. Werner Schroeder, Ascended Master Teaching Foundation founder, recalls briefly his encounter and interviews with Alice Schutz, whom introduced him and his wife to the Ascended Master teaching. He came to know her after reading the Law of Life book. Our quest for illumination and truth all started in earnest in the summer of 1976, when my wife Annette and I received a copy of the books The Law of Life by A.D.K. Luke. After reading the two volumes of this publication, we became enthusiastic about the teaching of the Bridge to Freedom, and we decided to start our own investigation as to why the books of the Bridge to Freedom were no longer available to the general public. Therefore, we wrote the author, Alice Schutz, the twin ray of the Ascended Master Jewel Kuhl, if we could visit and ask a few questions. Alice told me later that when opening my letter, she received a shower of energy on her back, which to her was a signal we should come. After arriving at her home in Oklahoma City, I asked 243 questions which I had prepared in writing. Not all the questions pertained to the teaching. Some of them concerned the translation into German of the Law of Life, which I intended to do at that time. It took 2 entire days to answer all of my questions. All of them were answered by Alice in her harmonious, calm voice. During the 20-hour interview, we were introduced to the fundamentals of Ascended Master teaching. When confronted with the question of why the public does not know more about the subject, she said of existing organizations, "Those who give it out haven't gotten it straight, and those who have it straight won't give it out." Some of the interview I recorded on tape. This interview provided the stimulus for my further research, which eventually resulted in the saving of the teaching. We learned that Alice had been an early supporter of the I Am activity. Together with Mr. and Mrs. Ballard, she traveled in an auto caravan across the United States. Mr. Ballard lectured to many audiences. Later, Alice assisted in compiling the first fundamental lessons of the I Am activity. After the ascension of Mr. Ballard in 1939, this organization charted a new course. Several key students, including Geraldine Innocente, her mother Mary Lehane Innocente, Mrs. Francis Eckey, Roger Ancona, and Alice Schutz left the activity and founded the Bridge to Freedom. Alice Schutz became a secretary of the Bridge to Freedom, working in Geraldine's home. The masters gave the dictations to Geraldine Innocente, usually starting at 4 a.m. The messages were recorded on a recording device. Alice transcribed the text messages and forwarded them to Mrs. Eckey, the assistant editor of the Bridge to Freedom. She also became one of the secretaries of Thomas Prince's Private Bulletin, a weekly publication of the Bridge to Freedom. Alice Schutz had been a member of the Philadelphia group of the Bridge to Freedom. The Ascended Host had called this group the most successful group since the fall of man. By Werner Schroeder, The Initiations of the First Ray.
My name is Werner Schroeder. I'm the founder of the Ascended Master Teaching Foundation. Before I describe the lecture series entitled The Ascended Masters Answer the Fundamental Questions of Life, I'd like to briefly mention a few things about myself. I was born and educated in Germany. I studied in Berlin, mechanical engineer. After escaping from the Russian-controlled sector of Germany in 1949, I became a citizen of the United States. Already when being 7 years old, I inquired about the fundamental questions of life, which are, why am I here? What is my purpose? What happens after I close my eyes after the end of this life? I was told no one knows the answer to these questions. My search for truth led me from being a member of a Lutheran church to becoming a Christian Scientist and later a Rosicrucian. Several years later, I heard about the teachings of the Ascended Masters. I asked for an interview with Alice Schutz, former secretary to Geraldine Innocente and an eyewitness to the dictations given by the Ascended Masters to Miss Innocente. During an interview lasting for several hours, I was introduced to the basics of the teachings of the Bridge to Freedom. After the interview, I decided to take an early retirement from my job and move to the town of Manchester. Thanks to the dictations of the Ascended Masters, students now have access to a treasure house of information never before available to mankind since the days of Atlantis. Therefore, based on the teachings of the Ascended Masters, we can now answer the questions: why am I here? What is my purpose? What happens after I close my eyes after the end of this life? In order to achieve the ascension, a student needs to study and apply the teachings and understand the reasons why.
That's just a personal comment. I'm so happy to be here. They made, for instance, Scott. We just, before the meeting, we exchanged some experiences. When I came first to Alice Schutz, she was my first teacher. I had prepared 224 written questions, and it took 3 days to answer them. And Alice was so patient and answered them all. And most, I would say 90%, she just answered just like that. And then say 10%, she said she had to do some research on them. Mm-hmm. So all I can say is Alice, truth bless her heart, she was very important to the teaching. She inspired us, and my wife and myself, and it made, gave us the certainty that gave us the courage to go ahead.
All right, let me just kind of explain who I am. I'm Scott Guthrie. I live in Portland, Oregon now, but I'm originally from Ohio. All right, so I came across the books originally from Ohio. There's a person who did an internship, a professional internship in my office for 6 months around 1986. I was just a young guy, and I was kind of starting to search. And this woman, I asked her, you know, we started talking about spiritual stuff, and I asked her what books she read, and she said, "Well, I read these white, yellow, and green books," and that's all she said. And it drove me nuts. So I used to go to this bookstore and walk down the aisles and just kind of feel things out. And sure enough, the seventh ray, the white book that Werner and Annette Schroeder put out, AMTF, fell on the floor in front of me. And I picked it up, and I knew instantly, because I had been reading Theosophy, I knew instantly what the seventh ray was, at least the connection to it. And I read that, and I knew instantly that this was it. It was clear and concise and to the point, and there were no veils or anything. So I got together with her, and she knew from my face, you know, that something had happened. So I told her, and she invited me over, and she showed me the white books and the green books and the yellow books, the Law of Life books. And she said, "Hey, the author of the Law of Life is in Colorado now, and she welcomes students to come out for classes." So I instantly got a hold of Alice and found out when a class was, and she would hold these classes that were maybe a week long, four or five days, or sometimes a week, whatever students could do. And she would open up her house, and then we would stay in a small hotel nearby, but she would open up her house, and we would be there pretty much all day, and we would be decreeing and talking. And anyways, that's how I got to know Alice. And then in 90, I really became involved in like 87, 88. And then from 88 to 90, I was heavily involved in helping Alice in any way I could. I was going out there all the time to Colorado from Ohio, which is about a 30-hour drive. And I would typically drive it and then, take a week off from work because I could. And I would, a week or two, I'd hang out with Alice. And then I decided, I got the prompting to move there. So I moved there in 90. And then Alice made her transition, made her ascension in 94, in I think late January of 94. But let me just kind of go over the beginning. So if you can go back one slide. Yeah, before joining the activity, I just want to kind of get you some history, because I have some interesting stories about Alice before she got into the I Am activity. So she was born on April 10th, 1905. She had Swiss parents. She was outside of Oregon, in Salem, Oregon. She had all sisters, but she was the only one that worked in the field with her father. And she was so proud of that, the fact that, she had such a great work ethic that her father saw that and took her out in the fields, and she did a man's work. She had questions about Christianity and Jesus as a young girl. She was sitting there on Christmas Eve, I believe. The Christmas tree was up. She didn't think that what was out there about it was correct. And Jesus appeared to her, but did not say anything. But there was a connection. There was kind of communication there without talking. And his presence was, she saw him in the room. She read Unveiled Mysteries. Somehow she read Unveiled Mysteries, and somebody gave it to her, like sitting down at the kitchen table, and she found out about it, and she started reading it, and she instantly knew that was it. She decided right away to basically stop what she was doing and go help the Ballard. She found out about the Ballard. She found out that they were starting to caravan around the country as a group and have these meetings and decree sessions and all of it. And she got involved with that early on. Probably, I'm guessing, late 34, 35, 1935. So the Ballards would go all around the country and have these meetings, building this momentum of this work coming in. And Alice was right there. She was there every day, and she just would make it work. She didn't have a lot of money, but she figured out ways to eat what she had to eat, and that was about it. And she was able to stay with people, and she was helping out. She became this person that, after the meeting with the Ballards, she would take notes during these live events. She would take great notes, she'd take notes on aspects of the law to kind of decipher it on her own time, to understand it better. And not a lot of people did. They heard what Mr. Ballard was saying, but she really got into the work. Once to see a movie. She had never seen a movie before. And her first and only movie that she saw in a movie theater was The Wizard of Oz when it came out. And all these people went out and they were looking for seats. And it just so happens that she sat next to Mr. Ballard during the movie. And he nudged her during the scene where it is the Emerald City. And he said, that's very, very similar to the Temple of Truth. Again, she was always behind the scenes. But again, the Alice way was, and this is very much to all cool, she would get and understand the organizational structure of things. And that's why she became the secretary, because Dua Kul, her twin, is known for knowing all the different masters and what their aspects are, what they're good at, everything. So she was kind of, because she's his twin, that was very similar in a way to what his aspect was or is. She helped write the basic fundamental, basic fundamentals in the IAM activity. If you don't know, there, she saw a need for people coming into the IAM activity with the green books that didn't have a good base structure on what all this meant, right? And how it all kind of came, worked together, and what the basic ideas were. And she saw a need for creating, lessons that would assist people to have a better understanding of the basic idea of the IAM activity and this new teaching. So she helped create those. She really, I think, created those herself pretty much. She said that when Mr. Ballard, he gained his ascension in 1936, but he waited until 1939 to kind of keep the organization, keep the activity going. After Mr. Ballard ascended, the IAM activity kept going on, basically from the 1940s to the 1950s. Alice was involved. And this is a point that most students maybe don't get. There have been two accredited messengers by the masters. The accreditation part is, look, the masters, they can only do things that are cohesive with the law of life, right? The certain laws. And the law of balance, the law of economy, it comes into play in how they use their energy. So they're not whimsical about who they choose to be an ascended master messenger, right? It doesn't mean that people don't get messages from the masters, but it means that there's an accreditation process on the inner and the outer that goes on, basically initiations, that goes on to become an accredited messenger of the masters. Alice believed, as I do, there were only two. Okay, Mr. Ballard and Geraldine Innocente from the bridge. What happened was there was a meeting and Alice was involved in the meeting. Now, again, Alice wrote the basic fundamentals. And what happened was there was a meeting about demanding that students do the basic fundamentals twice a year, no matter what. And Alice was like, well, wait a minute, you have these people that already know the basic fundamentals. They're in decreeing. Why should we waste that time together when we can be decreeing rather than enforce these educated, advanced students to keep taking these basic fundamental classes? And she was not heard. And the decision was made to make the IAM activity kind of secretive. You had to be a card-carrying member, and you can only get a card if you did the basic fundamentals twice a year. And what happened with the books was you could only get the books through them. And the idea was the masters wanted this material open to everybody who desired it. And that stopped. So it was the card-carrying twice a year fundamental idea, and the stoppage of the books in general that really halted the IAM activity from an inner standpoint. The masters had to kind of, step away. They were still decreeing, and that's wonderful. But the idea of the IAM activity being this open resource for people who desire this information was gone, pretty much. So the masters contacted certain students about, and they contacted students that they had a past relationship with, they had a strong connection to. The master sent letters to Mrs. Ballard multiple times, trying to convince her that, look, there's the reasoning for this new activity, that it's nothing against her and what has happened, but there's a change. And would they've been able to get a dispensation of energy, El Moria was, to start this new activity. Okay, so she in no way went for that. She did not believe it. Mrs. Ikki, who I just adore, I've never met Mrs. Ikki, but for some reason, I just am fascinated with her, and I'll talk about that later on. She had this Philadelphia group in Philadelphia of the I'm activity, really the strongest group. It was the decree group of all the decree groups in the I'm activity, right? And you have to understand, Mrs. Ikki, she ran a tight ship. But she was very, very powerful and such a good group leader, right? And if you were in the Philadelphia group, it was 100% or nothing. And it was, you got in there and you got to work, right? And Mrs. Ballard showed up one day unannounced, walked in while they were having a decree group and meeting, walked in unannounced, and announced that, look, you have to make your decision now. You're either with me or you're excommunicated. And I think pretty much everybody went with the bridge that were there. At some point, I think in 1948, before the bridge, Alice joined Mrs. Ikki's sanctuary. And it was called the 100% group in the fact that, you know, they got together, they didn't really miss. There were probably only 10 or 12, maybe at the top, 15 people in that sanctuary group. But, you know, again, when they got together and they were very strong decreers. The bridge, the organizational structure of the bridge, they had, their idea was, we have this momentum. Let's take this chance. We have 20 years dispensation energy in which to work with. And El Moria got in 1950, 51. The bridge started in 52. They were preparing Geraldine Innocente to become a messenger in about 1948. Really, actually, 1944. El Moria appeared to Geraldine and ask her to do certain things on a daily basis, basically preparing her to become a messenger. So again, that's how difficult it is to become an accredited messenger for the masters. Okay, so that's how serious they take it. It was also the start, the bridge. One of the main things is that they started the idea of the transmission of the flame. The masters felt like with its advanced students, the idea was they would work hand in hand with the students right then and there. There was no lag. Things were happening on the inner as they were decreeing for it on the outer or visualizing it on the outer. And that had never been done before. So the whole transition of the flame thing was new. And that's what really the Philadelphia group, when they started that, especially the Philadelphia group, but there were people all over the world doing it in the bridge, small groups. But that's what really accelerated giving back a good constructive energy that the masters could use when that started.
So this is really important. There were some dispensations that happened in the 50s because of all the work that was done, the impersonal service that was given, and the big stockpile of energy. And one of them was, it used to be that you had to get rid of 100% of all your misqualified energy, right, to make the ascension, which is unheard of. You know, the people were ascending one a year at times, right? Nobody was ascending, and these people were going into caves trying to get a feeling about their I am presence or whatever. And again, they had to go within and, you know, understand all this. But what happened was, because of the dispensation, because of all the great work that happened in the bridge, there was a dispensation given that the master said that it went from 100% to 51%. Mm-hmm. So life was saying, you clean yourself up to 51%, just over 50%, and you can gain the ascension if you choose. Okay. Also, there was another dispensation given. So if after you embody, if you can also gain the ascension on the inner, which is a lot easier to do, right? Rather than physically here, because it used to be you had to do it physically here. The author lives in Colorado and you can go visit her. So I think that week I called Alice, and Alice said that she was having some kind of get together. And that just meant that people from around the country, around the world, would go and hang out with Alice for maybe a week and be around Alice, right? And she would talk. And
Alice Schutz,
yeah, A.D.K. Luck, who wrote the Law of Light books,
right?
So I went out there, and I remember the first time I met Alice, very quiet, in her, late 70s, 80s. And she had these cute little dresses that people would give her. And I think they were probably from the 30s, right? So she would wear these dresses and all that. And she was getting still. All these people were talking in the room when I first met her. And there was a gentleman talking and talking and talking. And I thought, well, that must be her right-hand man because he's doing all the talking. And it wasn't, I found out. But Alice was getting still, and she used to get still when people would visit. And people wouldn't really recognize this most of the time. She would get still and try to get a prompting on what these people maybe needed at the time. What was the subject? What was their kind of question? You know, what can she do to assist these people on the path, right? Right. So at some point, whatever your background is, you have to be aware of your own individualized God presence and the tools, the violet flame.